Okay, so we are now recording the class live, so you don't need to worry, don't need to do anything about it. Okay, so this class is on the accounting. So we will be discussing only the accounting aspects. There are accounting and then there is a financial analysis. So we will not be covering the analysis part, because that's a different class. So here we're going to be learning how we do the accounting in hotel management and how we generate the financial statements. Okay, so we're going to be looking at both the balance sheet and basic accounting. So even though I know most of you, actually all of you are not from the finance background, so not from the accounting background. So I will try to explain in a logical way how to do the accounting as well. Okay. So accounting, hospitality accounting is, any accounting is usually the similar in basic structure, but hotel accounting is slightly different from a couple of points. So we will be learning those points, and then we will be seeing how you need to understand, because to understand the profit and loss statement, you need to learn what is the basic of accounting as well. Okay. So everybody, have you not done any formal accounting in the formal class of accounting, right?
Only
SCCI. Only SCCI. Oh, so you have done SCCI. So you know what is debit credit?
Yeah, but 2 years ago.
Two years ago. Okay. Okay, so I'll explain you the class slightly, very easy way, because I didn't make any presentation for the accounting aspect. So I will explain you what is accounting. You have heard of financial statements, right? What are the financial statements that you use normally? Maybe I can see that paper. Okay, so there are few financial. So you have learned about, are you all okay in English or you need to get it translated? It's okay, right? Okay. So hotel, any financial, any accounting, the main objective to run the accounting is to generate a profit and loss statement. Correct? And also to run the balance sheet and a cash flow. Usually the non-financial people, they know about profit and loss and balance sheet. They don't know about the cash flow part of it usually. So cash flow is important only for mostly accountants. But for non-finance people, it's also important, because it tells a lot of things that profit and loss and balance sheet is not telling. Okay. So to make these three statements, you need to have transactions. Correct? Every company has a transaction. When you invest money, this is a transaction. So in accounting, basically you have two sides of every transaction. Every transaction will have two basic sides. One is, in traditionally we call them debit and credit. Traditionally, credit is on the left side, credit is on the right side, debit is on the left side, usually. Okay? So whenever we say, okay, now for example, and when we make an account, so we normally have a different type of books that every company usually maintains. So one is called cash book, to maintain the cash transactions. One is bank book, to record the bank transactions. Sometimes you can record in one book also. And then you have a journal book. So journal can be different types. Journal can be a sales journal, a purchase journal. So sales journal will be used for what?
Sales journal.
Sales journal will be used for what? Will be used for recording all the incomes. And purchase journal will be used for recording all the purchases. Correct? So for example, now we limit our instructions to these two first. Okay, and then you have normally a general accounting called general ledger. So general ledger is for recording all your assets, liabilities, expenses usually. So for example, when you bring a capital, correct? Well, say you start a business. So what is the first financial transaction that you do? You bring in a capital, correct? You bring in your initial capital whenever you start a business. So first thing is you need money to start any business. Maybe it's $100, maybe it's $100,000, or it's $1 million. The important is you need a capital, correct? So the first entry that any accounting book will start with the introduce of capital. So the introduce of capital in accounting, you normally have three rules to do debit and credit. What goes as a debit and what goes as a credit. So credit usually means whatever is coming in. And whatever is going out is usually debit. Okay, so we have so when the capital is coming, so capital is for a business, it's a liability to the owners. Whenever that it means the business is coming. So what is coming in is the cash. Okay, so the first rule is debit, what comes in, and credit, what goes out. So this is first rule of accounting. Whatever is coming in, it will go to debit. So for example, in our accounting transaction, the first transaction, what is coming in? Cash. Right? So what you do is cash debit. Let's say you bring in $100,000 or maybe $1,000 to start with. So what you will do is you will debit your cash account. Every account has two sides, debit and credit. So what you will do is you will do a cash debit, right? So okay, capital account $1,000. So where you will do the credit? Every transaction need to have two sides. One will be debit, something will be credit, debited somewhere. So the same account will be credit somewhere else. So where it will go credit? It will go credit in your capital account, right? So you have two accounts now, credit into the capital. So second rule is, this is first rule, second rule is debit all your assets and credit all your liabilities. All your liabilities will be credit, all your assets will be debit. So capital is a liability for the business because it's introduced by the owners. So at any point of time, business need to return the money to the owners again. So it's a liability. Whatever you need to give back to anyone, be it your owner, be it your supplier, be it your creditors, your employees, it's a liability. Okay, so that is the first transaction. So after this first transaction, what you are doing? Sometimes you may be spending money, right? So you may hire an employee. So that comes to the third rule here. So the third rule says, debit all your expense and credit all your income. Okay, so let's say now you pick another account, you hire one employee and you pay him a salary, right? So you open a salary account. So first thing you need to do is you pay him a salary after 1 month. So let's say you pay him a salary of $100. Correct. So what will be the account? What will be the, what is going out? Cash. So cash means what? So what will happen is it will be credit. Correct. So it will be credit. Let's say we do a salary account, $100. And what will be the debit? Expense. Correct. Your salary account. So debit will be coming from cash, $100. So this is your second entry. Whenever I am writing here the reference of the account where the second entry is going, so that I know where this entry is coming from and I can cross reference. When I say capital 100, 1000 means in the cash account, I am saying this money 1000 come from where? So it's come from the capital account. And in capital account, I am telling where the credit coming from, is coming from the cash. And in salary account, I am saying where the money is going to. From the, where's the money going from? Cash, right? $100. And where I'm, what I'm doing is I'm telling the cash account that I'm doing the credit of salary, which is $100. Let's assume there's one more transaction. there is the electricity that you hire a rental, right? You now the rental is, you understand already, if I say you pay $100 as a rent, you know what you do, right? You will credit your cash and debit your rent account, not a salary account, maybe another rent account. But what if I say you didn't pay any rental yet, but this month rental is due? So do you need to record a transaction or not? Let's say this is month of June, or this is the month of June, right? Or month of May has just finished, and you taken the office on rental, and the rent is not yet paid, because normally sometimes you can, you need to pay rental in advance. But let's assume you didn't pay any rental for last month. So what will you do in the month of June? You need to record the liability, because rental is already become a liability for you. You need to pay at any time in future, right? So what you will do is, first thing is your expense, because rental is your expense, it's not your asset. Rental is your expense. So you will record, let's say, as $100 again, but you did not pay in cash yet. So you cannot say cash, correct? And you cannot record as a cash also here, rental, because you did not pay any money yet. So what you will do is, you will record a liability account, means a supplier. So you will put another account called owner, owner of the building, and then you will say, okay, so the entry will be in the liability side, in the credit side, because what we say in our rule is credit the liabilities, right? So you will say, okay, rent $100, correct? Clear, huh? And now next month we pay the rent, because the owner is, otherwise they're gonna kick us out from the operating. So we pay rent. So what will be the entry now? Once we pay the rent, rent is credit, cash is credit, right? Because cash is going out, and what is happening? Owner will be debit. So we will say cash, 100, right? Means you are reducing the liability. So one rent. So now here is another rule notification: credit when liability increase. And asset debit when asset increase, but when liabilities are decreasing, then you need to debit them. And when liability assets are decreasing, you will credit credit the assets. Okay. So here owner's liability is reduced, so that's why we debit them. Or you can use another logic, is because one entry is credit, so it has to be debit somewhere, right? So you debit it to the owner account, because you are paying to the owner. So this account is square off. Normally whenever we prepare the financial, now this is general accounts, correct? So what you do at the end of the month, you will take a balance. Okay, debit is 100, credit is 100. So the net is 0. Here debit is 1000, credit is 200, correct? So the balance is 800, right? So you can say balance. This is 1000 only credit, there is no debit side. So we call it a balance of 1000. Right? Rent is again only a debit. So it's a balance again. And salary is also balance. So we make at the end of the month, every month, we make something called trial balance. And we record all the transactions. Debit transactions, debit side, credit transactions, credit side. So the cash is a debit, right? Cash is debit is more. So let's say this is debit side. So the cash balance is 800. And credit side, the capital account is 1000. Correct? And then what else is the balance? This one is already 0. This one is 800, we wrote down. And these two accounts are debit accounts. So we will write down here salary and rent, 100 and 100. So the trial balance will always tally together. Okay, it has to tally together. So the total of credit side is 1000, total of debit side is also 1000, right? 800, 900, 1000. It has to tally all the time. This is the minimum requirement. If it does not tally together, it means your accounting is wrong. It has something wrong. Okay, it has to tally. Otherwise, your accounting is wrong. Nowadays, you don't do the accounting manually like we are doing. So you are doing in the system, and system will not accept any entry unless the debit side and credit side is same. So there is no chance that your trial balance will not be tallied, usually for accounting systems. But if the accounting system, if your trial balance is not tally, either the system is wrong or your transactions are wrong. Okay, so this is how we make up to the trial balance. You are clear about this? Everybody clear about this, eh? So after the trial balance, so we just erase only the except the trial balance. Okay, so in the financial statement that we earlier said, we're gonna make a profit and loss, we're gonna make a balance sheet, and we're gonna make a cash flow, right? So all the three things will only be coming from the trial balance. So this is your basic accounting, basic document that is produced at the end of the month after doing all the transactions, after looking at the cash, looking at the journal, looking at all the accounts. So this is the final document, that the first document that the finance account will produce, trial balance. So first thing is to prepare a trial balance and see all your debit transactions and credit transactions are matching together, correct? So that is the first requirement. And then you make a profit and loss. So how you make a profit and loss? In the profit and loss, there is no debit side, no credit side. In balance sheet, there is no debit side, no credit side. The debit and credit works only up to the general accounts and under the trial balance. In the profit and loss statement, you have an income side and expense. Correct? All the income will go here, all the expenses will go here. So in our trial balance, we haven't made any income yet. Correct? We haven't made any income. So income is zero. But we have two expenses here, right? You have salary expense and you have rental expense. Correct? So you will record 100 and 100. So what does it say? It means you have a loss, right? So now let's make a balance sheet. Balance sheet also have only two sides. One is asset side and one is liability side. Okay? You can write income here also, expense here. It doesn't matter. You can make your P&L statement, income and expenses. You can make it horizontal, you can make it vertical, you can write down expense here, income here, it does not really matter. Okay, there is no standard formula or standard format for making a P&L, making a balance sheet. It all depends on your personal preferences or on your organizational standards. It can be debit side, it can be credit side, it can be anything. Only the debit and credit side are normally fixed in any accounting. Debit side is always on the left side and right credit is always on the right side. So the balance sheet, liabilities. So what are the liabilities in here? Capital, right? So you have a capital which is 1,000 and you have a cash which is 800. The expense will never go to balance sheet. Expense will always go to only the profit and loss. And this profit and loss, whatever is the balance. So here you are making a loss, right? So loss will come here. Loss is 200. And then these two sides are together, is matching. This loss will be carried forward to the balance sheet. So which side it will come? It will come here or it will come here?
Assets.
Actually, it's not your asset. So what you will do is, because it's a loss, means it's a loss of capital. If you are the owner, you have 1,000. Now you run the business, you make 200 loss. So how much is your capital left? 800, right? So loss will be coming here, minus 200. So this amount will come to this side. And then you will tally the balance sheet. So balance sheet is always tally also. Some companies can show loss here. It can be also, it doesn't really fixed formula, but usually loss is always deducted from the capital. So the balance will be 800. So this is your balance sheet. Okay. Now you make a cash flow. So how you will make a cash flow? So cash flow will tell you how the money is coming into the business and where is it going. Okay. So in the cash flow, it normally starts with the opening balance. So when you started the business, then is there any cash? There's no cash, right? Zero cash. And then what happened? You invest money, right? So we call it investment activities. So cash account is also separate into investment activities, into operational activities, and into financing activities. Investment activity means whatever investment you are coming. Either you are getting in capital, or you are buying capital, or you are getting a loan, it's all called investments. How the money is coming in. So the first investment activity was to get a capital, right? So we got 1,000, right? And then you did operational activity. So in operational activity, what did we do? We just only pay salary and rent, right? Two activities. So we did salary and rent. So minus, always is always minus, okay? Salary and rent together. And then it will tell you, financing activity we will not do. Financing means you are buying a capital asset or you are taking a loan from the money, right? So that's one investment. Sorry, capital is a financing activity. Investing or taking a loan is financing activity. Buying a capital asset or buying a share, buying a in building will be an investment activity. Okay, so the balance is 0 opening plus 1000 minus 800. And closing, finally the closing balance will be 800, and this 800 must match with your cash in your balance sheet at the end. Okay, so this is the basic of accounting, how the transaction starts, how is it recorded, and then where it goes in the trial balance, P&L, balance sheet and cash flow. Is it clear, right? Okay. Now we come back to our total accounting. This was the basic for you guys so that you can understand. Because in the future I will be showing you some of the accounting activities. So you should be able to understand that. Okay. So the ultimate goal for total accounting is to prepare the financial statements for management and tax reporting, right? So what is the financial report for management? You will need a profit and loss, you will need a balance sheet, you will need a cash flow, and for tax, what do you need? Tax, you need to submit your profit and loss statement and balance sheet, right? And then prepare management information reports. So every accountant, sometimes you may be asking, what is my cost management? What is my revenue analysis? So who you ask for? You will always go and ask the accountant, right? So the accountant is keeping a track of every management report normally, which is asked by the users or by the management. For operational control, for your operating accounting, your cost reports, right? Or your revenue management, daily revenue report. That's all prepared by finance. And also your ability to generate your ad hoc reports. In case you need anything special from the management, then the accountant should be able to generate that report as well. So that is the ultimate goal for accounting. So all your transaction, whenever you are deciding the chart of accounts, how you need to maintain your records, it all depends on what are our objective, ultimate objective. What format do we need? So the format of the accounting, format of the balance sheet, format of the ledger is all dictated by the management or your tax structure. Okay. So what is usually? Does anybody know what is usually? U stands for uniform. S stands for system. A stands for accounting and L stands for lodging. I is for industry. So the full form is Uniform System of Accounting for Lodging Industries. This is a standard issued by AHLEI. Here, this one. American Hotel and Lodging Educational Institute. It's a US-based association. They are the one who issue a uniform system of accounting for all the lodging industries and is usually recognized by worldwide management companies. All the international management companies, be it Hilton, Marriott, Intercontinental, they all ask for accounting to be done in this format because it's a standard format. And they define what is the meaning of average rate, what is the meaning of occupancy. Because normally, let's say for example, in your hotel, you may have different formula to calculate occupancy. And some hotels include free rooms, some hotel includes only paid rooms into occupancy. When I say my hotel occupancy is 20%, right? It may include free rooms and it may include paid rooms also, correct? Sometimes, so what is in your hotel? How you know how you calculate the occupancy? Does it include only paid rooms or free rooms? Only paid rooms. And your hotel?
We did both.
You did both. Yeah. So when you say your hotel is occupied 20%, it means
free rooms also.
And when he say he is occupying 20%, for him is only paid rooms. So means if let's say he say my hotel is occupied 18% and your hotel you say 20%, it may be the same number of rooms, same number of paid rooms. It doesn't mean your hotel is doing better by 20% because your hotel includes free room as well, right? So the AHE alliance or usually try to remove that difference. If your hotel is following usually, you will not be able to say your hotel is occupied 20%. Because that's wrong as per the definition. You can include only paid rooms into the calculation. Okay, so the usually is trying to remove that difference between the terms and between the terms used in the hotel industry. Okay, it is issued by the Hotelier Association and is accepted worldwide. And it prescribes the format also of the financial institution. So I will show you the standard format of profit and loss statements. These are prescribed by usually. So all hotel industries need to follow that. But many hotels are still not following the standard format because it's not compulsory. It's not forced by the law. It's forced only by the management companies at this point of time. And it showed consistency in comparison or reporting. So as per usually, there is a one grand profit and loss statement. So how the profit and loss statement structure of the hotel works is, there is one grand profit and loss, and then you have separate profit and loss for each department. So what are the departments in the hotel? You have different department, right? In the hotel industry, you have rooms department, you have front office department, you have other department, laundry, housekeeping, right? And you have maintenance department, you have sales and marketing department, or you have administrative departments. So the profit and loss is divided into different parts. So room division will have their own statistics and their profit and loss statement, and then there will be a F&B division. So there will be the outlet-wise P&L for each outlet if you have more than one outlet. Cover analysis reports, food cost reports, and then the other operating departments, means your spa and your laundry or all the revenue generating departments. And then you have administrative and general, you have sales and marketing, you have information technology. This is a new addition that was issued 2 years back. The uniform system of accounting needs all your IT expenses to be recorded in a separate P&L. Previous to this, all your internet expenses, telephone expenses, computer expenses were merged together with the other departments. For example, one computer is used by sales and marketing. So all the software costs, everything will go to sales and marketing. But now it's all combined into information technology as one department, so that hotels can be compared who is more advanced and how much they are spending in information technology separately. And then you have one for maintenance expenses and utilities. Okay? So this is the format of the grand profit and loss statement. So it says prescribed format. You will see the format in the Google Classroom. I upload the pictures there, so you can copy it. And I the other P&Ls I put into Excel as well, so you can copy the Excel. Okay, so how it works is you have two sections here. One is for the statistics: rooms available, rooms sold, occupancy, ADR, RevPAR, total RevPAR, right? Can anybody tell me what is total RevPAR?
Yeah. Room revenue, meaning occupancy, or total room divided by the sales of
No. Total RevPAR is the total revenue divided by the available rooms. Room RevPAR is only rooms revenue divided by the available rooms. So why you need RevPAR? You have ADR. So ADR there, and then the RevPAR is there, right? So these are the two things. So ADR is also average daily rate. And RevPAR means room revenue per occupied room, per available room. So what is the difference between these two?
It's overall, and now it's actual room we sell.
No, there is a difference. I will explain you the difference in the future slide. But ADR is only based on the paid rooms. So you calculate, if let's say your hotel has 100 rooms and you are able to make you are able to sell only 50 of them, and you make a revenue of 10,000, right? So your RevPAR, your ADR will be revenue divided by the 50 rooms, but your RevPAR will be revenue divided by the 100 rooms, because it's the total available rooms. So it helps to compare, because let's say the hotel has two hotels have a different rate, right? Some hotel is selling at $50 per occupied room per night, and the hotel is selling for $20 per night. So you cannot compare these two hotels if you want to know the efficiency of these two hotels, right? Because the rates are different. So you cannot compare the revenue so easily. So the better way to compare the revenue is compare how much they make per room. So if they have both have 100 rooms, so how much is the total room how much is the total revenue per available room they are able to make? That will define the efficiency of these two hotels, right? Not the daily rate. Because if let's say you are selling at a higher rate, you will have less room occupied. And if you are selling very cheap, your hotel will be full. Correct? So the idea is to understand how much we are able to make per available room, the revenue. So your strategy to sell cheap and get a lot of occupancy, or you want to sell high and get low occupancy. But the total revenue, the idea is to maximize the total revenue. Correct? So total revenue will be maximized if whenever our revenue RevPAR is the highest. So our goal is to always maximize the RevPAR. Then you have the second section. This second section is talking about the revenue and expenses, right? So here you can see operating revenue. We divide into room, front of food and beverage, other department, and miscellaneous income. So room income means only the room department income. F&B means all the F&B department revenue is collected there. All the maintenance, all the other departments' revenue is collected there. So other operating departments usually means spa, laundry, gift shop, or your transportation, if you are charging the guest for limousine services, if you are charging the guest for concierge services. So all that income is transferred to other operating departments. Miscellaneous income means if you are charging any group cancellation charges, or you are charging any sale of the amenities. So those are all miscellaneous income. And similar to this, we divide departmental expenses into each department, each operating department. So rooms division will have their own expense, F&B will have their own expense, and operating department will have their own expense, and other departments, your administrative general, information technology, sales and marketing, maintenance, utilities. So these are the different expenses. Okay, and then you have other non-operating. So this one grand P&L will be able to give you a fair idea of which department is working well, which department is not working well. Okay, only one by one you get the one page for each department, and then you have a different for each department. You have a separate profit and loss statement. That is to give you the detailed idea about that particular department. So normally, whenever we are preparing, so our ultimate, so normally the high management is normally interested only in the grand P&L. They are not normally interested into the individual P&L unless they see any problem. So if you see any problem, let's say the room's expenses are higher than, so here you are comparing your results for the month and year to date. So you have two things to prepare. One is for 1 month and another one is for year to date. Year to date, whenever your year starts, financial year. If your financial year starts in April, then the year to date today will be April, May and June. Correct? But if your financial year starts from January, then year to date means January, February, March, April, May and June. Okay? And we are comparing with your actual expenses with your budget. So normally you have to prepare a budget for the 1 year, right? In advance. So we are always comparing, accounting is always comparing with the budget and also the previous year. So if let's say you are a first hotel, new hotel operating in the first year, so your previous year will be zero, but you still have your budget if you have prepared a budget. So usually also recognize the uniform system of accounting also recognize you need to have a budget every year. Make a budget for next 1 year and then compare your results with the budget or your forecast, correct? And then compare with the previous year as well. So you compare in both in dollar terms and also in the percentage terms. Okay, clear here? Clear so far? So this is a one simple format with the figures. So these are the real figures from a hotel. So you can see here the total revenue for in this department is 77 million or 59% of total revenue. So this percentage is always calculated from the total revenue to show the relevance from each revenue. So here you can calculate the actual budget and the variance. So variance column is not in the standard. In the standard format doesn't give you the variance column, right? But if you want to make it easy for management to understand the variance, then you can provide a variance column. Otherwise, your management will keep on doing the calculator, right? To calculate the variance from each and every line separately. So it's better to keep a variance column with the last year and again one more variance, so that it's easy to read the P&L. Otherwise, it will be very difficult. This is only one side of P&L. The other side of P&L is normally for the month. This is for year to date. So normally P&L will be on two sides. This will be in the center. One side will be for the month and another side will be for the month to date figures or year to date figures. Okay. So here you can see for each department, operating expenses, other distributed expenses, and then the other statistics. Here in the standard P&L, the statistics are on the top side, correct? And it's not calculating any profit or labor cost or other expenses. But this, it depends on the hotel. It's not a standard, but you can calculate the profit percentage. You can calculate the RevPAR, you can calculate the labor cost, FTE. It's just to give more information to the user in one page. So you are able to calculate the profitability for each department separately, so that we don't have to calculate manually by one. 77 minus 13 is 63, right? And so you are actually calculating and telling the user automatically. So giving more information than what is the minimum. So this information is the minimum. Your hotel must have this information as a minimum. You can provide more information if you want to make it easier for the management. Okay. So you have a look. Does your P&L, have you ever looked at your P&L in your hotels? Do you? Huh? No. And it's your own individual P&Ls, your own hotel P&Ls. Do you look at P&L or not?
Yes.
You look?
Yeah.
Is it the same? Or what is missing?
Almost same.
Almost same.
The second sheet will replace the third part in which?
Hmm?
Third part.
Which one?
Same.
This one is same. Okay. So your outer table is similar to this.
Yes, but also the type A up and down.
Yes, that one is okay. Usually you can have the titles up and down. Sometimes you show statistics here. Some orders will show statistics at the first. Some orders will show at the end. So it doesn't really matter. The more important is you need to have the information there. Because it depends on the user, how they want to read the information. Okay? This is the room division creator. This is a standard version. So the standard version is you have a revenue which is divided into each market segment. So we will look at the market segments later. What is retail, what is discount, what is negotiated, qualified or wholesale. We will do that later on. But for the time being, we just need to understand that room revenue will be divided into each market segment. So that we can understand where the hotel business is coming from. And your expenses are also divided into labor cost and non-labor cost. So there will be two parts of the expenses. One is related to labor, means your salary, your wages, your meal, transportation of the employees and everything else, and other operating expenses, which is non-labor, means your supplies, your amenities. I will not go through the detail of each and every line item. I will give you a complete guide in Excel. So you can search by yourself. If cleaning and supplies, what goes inside the cleaning and supplies? So there's an Excel sheet. I will show you the Excel sheet later on. Then you can search by yourself. We will cover only the major expenses. I will cover the major expenses. Okay? So this is another simplified format of room division P&L. Normally in the hotel actual P&Ls, the market segmentation is not shown into the P&L. It's a separate report, usually. So you combine only the revenue side and expenses side. Okay? And you have complete expenses. And then the room segmentation is shown separately. Okay? So room segment report is done separately. So you are here again comparing room nights, average rate, and the revenue. Compare with the budget and previous year. In the profit and loss statement, you will not see room night and ADR in the profit and loss statement. But you will see it in a separate report, which is called market segmentation report. Do you see this report? Everybody of you see this report. Do you understand what is retail? No, the market segment. What is the meaning of retail market segment? Okay, I will explain to you later. I will explain to you. There is a slide for that. So first we finish up the formats. Okay, then this is F&B division P&L. F&B division P&L is also dividing the F&B revenue into two parts: food and beverage. Food revenue and beverage revenue. And each revenue is divided into by venue, your in-room dining, your each and individual outlet, right? Your banquet, mini bar, or if you have more than one outlet, one F&B outlet in your hotels. So each hotel need to have their own separate revenue and separate expenses. This is a combined one. You can have similar P&L for each and every outlet separately, because you can easily identify the room revenue, the food cost, the cost of sales. Cost of sale is also cost of food, cost of beverage, and your labor cost and other expenses. So this is a standard P&L. It's a simplified function again. We just remove the outlet-wise information into separate sheet, and then we record only the food revenue and beverage revenue in a summary version, so that we can compare. We can read the P&L easily. Then the other departments. So is that, well, for each department you can have a separate P&L, or this is a combined P&L for all the departments take together. This one is for administrative and general. This also is usually all the expenses we are dividing into labor costs and other expenses. So these are the expenses which are not related to labor cost. Okay. Sales and marketing. So all the P&Ls are different, but there is a standard P&L. But all the P&L will run into a similar structure. They separate labor cost in general and other non-labor cost. Okay. So labor cost we will learn in more details in the coming slides. So the unique feature of accounting means we normally do accounting for each cost center. So what is the meaning of cost center? What do you understand by when I say is a cost center? What is a cost center? Very quiet classroom. Okay, the cost center means wherever you can segregate your revenue and expenses into one department. For example, room department is a cost center because rooms, they have their own revenue, they have their own expense, they have their own management. The front office manager, you will not be, or restaurant manager will not be able to decide anything in front office, right? They are not going to make any impact on the room division P&L. F&B is separate cost center, correct? If you have a restaurant called, let's say you have an all-day dining restaurant where you are serving your breakfast or your lunch or your dinner. So that's a separate cost center because it can have their own revenue and their own expense. And there is somebody who is in charge of that particular section, right? Correct? And sales and marketing is another cost center. So sales and marketing is usually who decides the cost of the sales and marketing. It's the director of sales and marketing, right? So director of sales and marketing influence all the cost of sales and marketing department. No other department is influencing it. And they are responsible for their own expenses, correct? So that's another cost center. So cost center is any of your department which is independent in terms of revenue, in terms of cost and in terms of expenses. Then you normally have statistic accounting. In hotel, you need to record a lot of statistics. Your occupancy, ADR, covers, average check. These are all statistics that hotel is normally recording and presenting for operational controls. Then you have some operational reports. Operational report means your operating equipment report, your cost reports, correct? All these are operational reports. And you have market analysis report. So the accounting softwares for hotels are meant to describe the market analysis. Your room revenue analysis, your F&B analysis, right? So there are a lot of market analysis reports. That one we will learn into deep details of each segment, where, how is it coming from. The cost center accounting means wherever we record the income and expenses for each profit or cost center. And it enables to identify the performance of that particular department. So you need to have a budget for each cost center, for one budget or performance metrics for room division, one for F&B, one for laundry, one for housekeeping, one for administrative departments, marketing department, maintenance department. So these are all the cost center in hospitality. So it requires proper allocation of common expenses. So sometimes your expenses are common, right? For example, your employee meals. When your staff is going to the canteen, do you know how much the maintenance staff is eating, how much the sales staff is eating, how much finance is eating? Cannot, right? It's very difficult to know. So how you do allocation? Total cost divide by how many people are eating there, right? And how many people are eating means every day you can calculate, you can count how many people are coming to work. So total meal, how many people in the whole month, and then you divide as per the number of employees for each department. So that's how you allocate the common expenses. But why you need to allocate the common expenses? So that you can understand the performance of each department separately, right? Your laundry expense, your uniform washing is a common expense, correct? So that expense also need to allocate. So in hotel, normally in other companies or other industries, there is no common expense allocations. Usually it's separate. But in hotel industry, you have common departments which are serving everybody. For example, laundry, for example, meals, for example, your dishwashing. So a steward is washing for all the outlets. Let's say, for example, you have a common kitchen and your hotel has five different outlets. So sometimes you may have one pastry kitchen only. Not every outlet will have their own pastry, right? So you need to be able to allocate to each cost center the cost of pastry department. So that's why the hotel accounting is more complicated for allocation. Allocate the cost to each and individual cost center. Okay. And then the cost center is to be determined based on the level of their operation. If let's say there is a department which is very small, for example, maybe your transport department, very small, maybe only once in a month, twice in a month, you have a limousine rental. So you will not try to open a new cost center for that one or two transaction only. You will just merge into the basic bigger department. And usually concierge is controlled by front office, right? So you will record all the income and expenses into the rooms department or front office department. You will not open a new department for concierge separately. Unless it's a very big department and they have their own revenue separately. They have their many employees, right? Then it's a separate department. Otherwise, it's not a separate department. So it depends, because the more cost center you have, the more problem it is for you to allocate the expenses into each and individual expenses, individual cost center. So less cost center means you have less work, but you will have less details of control. So hospitality operation, and this is how we define the cost centers. So once you have a general management and then you have a room division, so it's divided by the divisions. So each division will have a separate department, like front office, housekeeping, concierge. Food and beverage usually have one holiday dining restaurant and some specialty restaurants. You have kitchens, you have administrative departments. Then you have other departments, means you can have spa, you can have laundry, you can have transportation, gift shop. It depends on the hotel size. Some hotels can have more than this, some hotels have less cost centers. But this is more or less the usual organization structure of the hotels. So you can have administrative department, means you have finance, accounting, HR. Some hotels have no HR. It's actually managed by the GM only directly or by the finance and accounting. IT, sometimes they don't have anyone. Executive office is usually there is only one GM only. There's nobody else. So sales and marketing, reservation can be separate. Some hotel may have same department for marketing and sales. No separate marketing, no separate sales or revenue management. It can be only one department. So depend on the hotel size, depend on the complexity of the operations. It can separate into different factors. But when you decide the cost center, the structure of cost centers, you need to see, do you really want to see the cost separately or not? Is it important for you or not? Right? If it's not important, then you don't need to bother creating a new cost center. Then you can just merge into a larger cost center. So you don't need to separate every cost out. Okay, so we already discussed the type of books that we need to maintain. So hotel accounting is maintaining normally a cash book and a bank book, which is recording the cash transactions, and a general ledger. This is called journals for sales, for purchase, for your cash, for your expenses. And this you normally have a main, depend on the main chart of accounts, and then you can have a sub ledger. So let's say, for example, labor cost, right? Or you can say compliment, or you can say gifts is a main account. But if you want to track this account more details, so you can have in-house gifts, outside gifts. You can have the gifts which are given to the sales, which are given by the GM. So you can track the separate expenses. So you don't need to open a new account for each type of activity. You can group the activities into one and then split in as a sub ledger. So you will have a detail, but when you want to combine into P&L, you can have as one expense line instead of multiple. And then you have subsidiary books, means account receivable. So these subsidiary books means it's a separate book maintained by the finance, but it has a total detail will tell you in the P&L, trial balance. So in the trial balance, you will see only the one name, total debtors, total agents. But the detail of the agents will be lying in your subsidiary books, means your AR accounts. So each agent will have a separate account. Imagine if you have 1,000 agents working for you, and you open one account for each and every one. So your trial balance will have 1,000 names, correct? So it's going to be very messy, right? So normally we open one main account, like debtors, right? And we report everything there. But we maintain separate ledger for each and every trial balance. So the total of two will be the same. But in the trial balance, you will see only one account, means account receivable. But for the other accounts, other details will be in your subsidiary books. In account receivable, normally is done for account receivable, account payable, and staff accounts. Let's say if you have a lot of account, lot of staff, and everybody is usually you are giving a loan to the staff or you are taking money from the staff. So normally you open a separate account for your staff, where you are doing the transaction for them. Right? You are giving discount, you are taking money from them, or you are charging money from them, or you are paying salary to them. So it's all recorded into the staff accounts separately. Okay. Then you, something is called chart of account. Chart of account means your main ledger. For example, when we discuss here in our accounting, salary is one chart of account, rent is one chart of account, right? Owner account is one chart of account, cash and bank is another chart of account. So it usually depend on the, it can be normally categorized into assets, liabilities, income and expenses, and memorandum. So chart of account will come from assets, liabilities, asset side, all your liabilities, all your income and expenses, and memorandum. So memorandum will be what? Memorandum will be your occupied rooms, number of rooms, covers, so that you can calculate the statistics. So assets can be further divided into fixed assets and current assets. What is fixed asset? Not only immovable. Fixed asset means whatever asset you can use for more than 1 year. The accounting definition is if you can use for more than one period, one accounting year, then it's considered as a fixed asset. Like for example, the projector. Correct? This projector you can use for maybe 2 years, 3 years, 4 years. So it's a fixed asset. But this pointer, maybe you can use for 6 months, 8 months, maybe a year maximum. After that, it will be break, right? So this will not be considered as a fixed asset. It will be considered as a current asset. Okay. All your assets which are going to be realized within 12 months is considered as a current asset. All your assets or like all your liabilities which are going to be realized after 12 months is considered as fixed asset. Okay. Then liabilities you can divide into equity. Equity means that's come from your owners, and your long-term liabilities means when you're taking a loan from the bank or you're taking a loan from your friends, which you have to pay after 1 year. If you have to pay within 1 year, it will be considered as current liability. Current means meaning within the 12 months. Okay, that's the accounting definition to categorize. Then your income and expenses you can divide into operating income or operating expense, means your main activities. So for a hotel, renting out the room or serving the F&B is an operating activity, main activity, right? But if the hotel has put up a hoarding outside their boundary and collecting the money, that is not hotel's operating activity, because that's not the main task of the hotel. Right? It's just a subsidiary task. You are there in the hotel, that's why the hotel is doing it, but as not the business of the hotel. So it's not a hotel business. Hotel's main business is to rent out the rooms and serve the F&B, restaurant business. So that's called operating. Non-operating means whatever income or expense they spend on other than operating expense. Like for example, they are making money. For the hotel, currency exchange, is it a main activity or not a main activity?
Non-operating.
Hmm? Currency exchange. Exchanging the currency for the guest. Is it a main activity for the hotel or not? It is.
Yes, it is.
It is, right?
Yeah.
So whenever the hotel is, where guest is staying in the room and they say they want to change a dollar, that's a main activity for the hotel. So it will be an operating income. But let's say the guest has given you the dollars and now you are selling that dollar as a settlement. Let's say your room department is, your room rate is $100. So the guest given you $100, correct? That $100 is already collected. Now you want to sell that dollar into the market after 1 month. So that if you make a profit or loss, is it your main activity or not? It is not your main activity. So the foreign exchange loss or foreign exchange gain after you collected the money is not considered your operating activity. But collecting the money, that is considered your main activity. So there is a very small distinction between operating activity and non-operating activity. Selling the assets, is it operating or non-operating? Let's say your hotel is renovating, right? So you have a lot of old furniture, old guest room furniture, you want to sell, right? So what is it? Is it an operating activity or non-operating activity? It's a non-operating activity because it's not hotel business. Hotel's business is not to sell the furniture. Hotel's business is to use it for the guest. So if you are renovating and it's an old furniture, you are selling it, means it's a non-operating activity. Memorandum accounts is usually for statistics and it's a single entry. So in the initial, I told you every accounting transaction need to have two sides. One is debit side and one is credit side. So these memorandum accounts is an exception to it. There will not be a double entry. So when you are recording number of room occupied, then you don't need to record a second entry for that. It's just one entry is finished. Okay. So this is an exception. So memorandum accounts or statistic account are exception to the general rule that there has to be a second entry for all accounting transactions. So what are the statistical accounts? Usually, normally is your occupied rooms, your F&B covers, your spa guests. Why you need to record that? Because in your room department, in your P&Ls, you saw a lot of statistics coming, right? You have operating, you have RevPAR, you have occupied rooms, you have ADR, you have F&B covers, per cover expenses. So those all statistics are coming from these memorandum accounts. Usually in the other industries, very less industries maintain statistical accounts. Hotel industry is very specific to the statistical account because it's revised a lot. Okay, and sometimes you have contra accounts.
Yes, I just want to check the question. If for the transportation, whatever gift shop is can operating income.
This is your main activity, hotel's activity. But renting out the shop is sometimes is not an operating activity. Means if you are, let's say the hotel has a rental shop.
Yeah, we give it to the others, it's not belong to us.
But no, normally the hotels, usually it's the business of the hotel to maintain the shops in the lobby and renting out as a normal business. So that's a normal business.
Okay.
That's still a normal business.
So this is not our operating.
This is your operating income.
Okay.
Because hotel is operating it.
So we give a rent to the outside.
So these are the memorandum accounts that you normally need to maintain for statistics. Available rooms. What is available room? Does anybody help me? Can anybody help me?
We can sell.
The rooms which you are able to sell. So okay, I will give you a question. Let's say your hotel has 100 rooms. Total 100 rooms, right? One room GM is staying for permanently. So will you consider it as a room available to sell or not? So it's 99 rooms available for sale. So the room which is occupied by house is staff. Staff, not by the guest, by the staff for free for a long-term usage. And long-term usage is defined by months, like 6 months. So if your intention is to let use this room for in-house usage, it will not be considered as room available for sale. Now another question. Let's say your bathroom is damaged, your bathroom is leaking, and your engineers say it is going to take 15 days to fix the room. Will you consider it as a room available for sale or not?
Yes, our service is all so we are available. It's only 99 rupees for sale for 15 days.
Yeah. So it still will be fit. No, but 99 is already there. One more room is broken.
98.
No. Only 15 days you will not take out from the available rooms.
Oh, okay.
Available rooms will be reduced only by long-term renovations. If you are closing down the hotel for a major renovation,
yes,
then you will say is out for renovation. So means that is considered as reducing the available inventory. But if it's just only a normal repair, let's say your bathroom is leaking, your carpet needs to change for 1 month, 3 months, 1 month, a couple of days, it will not be taken out of the inventory. It will still remain a part of your inventory.
Okay,
unless you are actually saying you are establishing that okay, the room will be closed for 3 months, and number of rooms will be closed for major renovation. That's the inventory you can take out from the from your inventory. Otherwise, you cannot take it out. Okay, so the purpose is to maintain the available inventory at all the same time, and to control the rooms available for sales. Okay. Okay, so that is available. Yeah. What is occupied room nights? Occupied room nights for usually for accounting purposes. Only the room which are sold. So it can be sold for a month, or it can be sold on a contract basis, or it can be sold on a day-to-day basis. But when we say occupied room nights in accounting, we are referring only to the room which are sold, not occupied by the staff for free or by the complimentary. Okay, there is a question. Let's say there are 10 rooms. Let's say there is a group, correct?
Yes.
There is a group of 10 rooms, and normally you allow one extra room for the agent or the tour leader for free. So that room will be considered as occupied room or not? Anybody else?
Complimentary
means this one doesn't include complimentary things. But that room, is it complimentary or it's not complimentary?
Occupied.
So it's not complimentary room. Who agrees?
There is different points of view between
the financial side. For financial reporting purposes, when we are discussing the usual standard of accounting, it is included as an occupied room, as a paid occupied room, if it's a part of a contract. So if your contract says you will give 10 rooms, for every 10 rooms, you will give one extra room for free to the tour leader. That's a part of a contract. So if let's say you are selling for $100, so hotel knows that I will get $1,000, but total of 11 rooms will be occupied. So we will consider 11 as a paid occupied rooms, and your ADR will be based on total revenue divided by 11 rooms, not by 10 rooms. Okay. So when we say occupied room nights, it's inclusive of that free room, which is a part of the contract. Okay. Then you have market segment information. So market segment information we will discuss in future. It's more about how the business is coming from. Your business coming from retail, your groups, your wholesale or online sales. Then you have average rate. So it's called average daily rate. So how is it calculated? Total revenue divided by occupied room nights. So occupied room nights is already defined as paid occupied room nights, right? It doesn't include the complimentary. And then you have food covers. So what is a food cover? Not only breakfast, it's lunch also.
Yeah.
It's the number of people who come to eat in your restaurant.
Yes.
Correct? If let's say one restaurant, the one guest is coming for lunch, and the same guests come for dinner, and the same guests come for breakfast also. So how many covers you will count?
Three.
Correct? Is number of times the person is coming. If even if it's the same person, you will count them as three. But even if, let's say during the lunch time, this person eats something and then settle the account. And but he's not yet gone. He ordered another thing. And he has again pay for it. Settle the account. Means you have a different check. And then he orders something again within the same setting. So will you consider three covers or one cover?
Separate check. It's each and every check we open one cover.
Actually it's not correct. You need to cover only as one cover.
Same guest.
Because it's not only the meaning of same guest. Because the person is not going anywhere. And he is sitting in the same period. So even if he ordered three times, three different checks, he is still considered as one cover. The point of covering the covers is how many times you need to set up your table. You can take it as a guidance from there. When the person is coming and he is sitting there, so you need to set up the table, you need to clean, right? And he goes somewhere and another guest comes, you need to clean again, right? And you will set up again. So if the same person is sitting on the table, he is not going anywhere, so you don't need to clean it again. You are not serving again. You are just taking an order and settling it. It's just a matter of taking order and settling it. So it's not a different cover. Because this covers will be considered for your productivity reports and for calculating how much one person is spending in each meal period. So if you cover as a three, if you count as three, then your productivity will be very high, even though you are not actually doing any extra service. Right? Beverage covers. If the person is eating only food, so and then after that he order a beer, so you will count this two cover or one cover. If the person is counting, let's say so you will count that as food cover or beverage cover.
Not sure.
It depends on the restaurant. If your restaurant is a food restaurant, then anybody who comes there will be considered as a food cover. If your restaurant is a beverage restaurant, is considered anybody who comes there is considered as a beverage cover, even though he is ordering the food. For example, the bars. There are some bars which are mostly serving beverages, but they serve snacks also. They serve burger, they serve sandwich, right? But even though it's a food, if somebody comes and order for that, it will be considered as a beverage cover. Because the main restaurant is beverage. Right? So, and when we decide which is a best beverage restaurant, which is a food restaurant, we decide normally by the majority. Means, what is the ratio? It depends on the hotel policy. Some hotels say, okay, if this restaurant, 60% or 70% revenue come from beverages, then it's a beverage restaurant. Is considered as a bar. If it's less than 70% food revenue or beverage revenue, then it's considered otherwise. So it depends on what is the major sale for that restaurant. If its majority is food, it will be considered as a restaurant. If its majority is the beverage, it will be considered as a bar. And the covers will be decided based on is it a food restaurant or is it a beverage restaurant. It's a bar. And then covers by each meal period. So normally you record covers for breakfast, for lunch, for dinner, or sometimes you can record supper and snacks. When the supper starts?
Sure.
Supper.
Supper is after dinner.
After dinner. Until what time?
Before the breakfast.
Before the breakfast. So supper starts after the dinner finish, maybe around 11 or 12. And then until the breakfast starts. Usually breakfast starts at what time?
6.
For example, I say. So normally, if it's an all-day dining restaurant, you will divide based on when your operation timings are, right? So morning 6 until 10:30 will be considered as lunch. After that, until the snack time, maybe 3:30, it will be considered as lunch. And then 3:30 to whatever the dinner time is starting, it will be considered as snack. Dinner time, it will be dinner, and after dinner, before breakfast, it will be considered as supper. So some hotels are recording separate for breakfast, lunch, dinner, supper, snacks. Some hotel, if they say you don't have a business, a lot of business in supper or in the snacks, then you don't need to calculate again. You don't need to separate. You can just merge together with the either the dinner or with the breakfast or with the lunch, depending on how you want to decide. It depends on the traffic. If you have a whole day traffic, then it's easier to separate out this to understand where your traffic is mostly coming from, right? But if it's not much of the business, then you can split into major three: breakfast, lunch, and dinner only. And then you have spa guests. How many guests are coming to take the massage, right? Then you have number of massage. If one guest is taking two massage, then you record as a two massage. Because you want to understand the average price of average price spent by the guest and average massage taken by the per guest. Usually the performance of the spa is maintained by how many massage we are able to sell to one guest. Because sometimes when the guest is coming, they not buy only one. You can upsell them and sell them other massages also, right? You can like a package, or you can sell them other treatments. So the if you record them separately, how many guests is coming, and how many treatments they use. So you can use that as a ratio, or you can use that as a performance target for the spa girls to sell more spa, to sell more treatments. But if you don't maintain the record, then you cannot set any target, right? And you have health club members. So how many members you have? You can record into separate. Monthly members, yearly members, daily members, quarterly members, corporate members, family members. It depends on what are the major business source. And you have laundry kilograms. Why you need laundry kilograms? How many kilogram laundry is washed by the monthly? And for which department? So normally this is recorded to allocate the laundry cost. So normally we are recording laundry cost and separating out the laundry cost into each department. That is done by the laundry. So all the laundry, common laundry expense is divided by the number of kilogram. Room department will have how many linens we are washing for them, how many uniform we are washing them by kilo. You cannot do by pieces, by kilo. And then number of staff. So you need to record number of staff to allocate the meal expenses, right? Okay. And there are some operational and marketing reports. Normally we are, finance is normally maintaining them. So one is called operating equipment. So every quarterly or every monthly you are counting operating equipment, right? So that's a part of the accounting. But there's no accounting done for actual counts. It's just a report. So you are just counting your accounting, your opening stock, and then count with the physical stock and compare. There's no need for any accounting entry except for loss and damages. So if you find any shortage, losses and damages, then you need to record as an expense. Otherwise, you don't need to do any accounting for actual count. Then you have PAR setting, right? You are setting a PAR for many things. You set up PAR for your ground stock, you set up PAR for your stores, you set up PAR for your food, you set up PAR for your beverage. You have different PARs, right? So those PARs are another accounting report, but there is no accounting done for PAR also. So I'm just telling you, these are the operational reports. So as a finance person, you need to be aware of these reports so that you can help the operation department making these reports. And then you have slow moving and non-moving reports, right? Who have seen slow moving or non-moving reports in your life? In your operation, hotel operation life, not life, in your hotel operation life.
Maybe at
home. So slow. What is the slow moving?
Items are the beverage items are very hard to consume.
It means they are very slow to move from the store. The guests are not eating them a lot. Is not being used. So slow moving we considered if it's not moving, if it's not moving for last 3 months already. So if there is no consumption of any stock item within last 3 months, it will be considered as slow moving. But if there is no consumption for past 6 months, then it will be considered as not moving at all. Okay. So normally the operational, when you are doing the operating equipment count, you normally are seeing, is there any report, is there any item which is not issued for more than 3 months? Is there any item which is not issued for more than 6 months? And what are the reasons for them? And normally you are discussing with the operation department how to use those assets. Because that's money that is invested already, right? But you are not getting anything out of it. And then you have normally expense breakdown. So you want to control your expenses. So you compare them per occupied room or per cover. So what are the expenses normally you compare per room? Labor? Do you compare labor cost by per occupied room?
It's a fixed cost,
right?
Yes.
So you don't compare the labor cost or you don't measure labor cost per occupied room, because even though you occupy one room or two room or three room, you still need the same housekeeping person, you still need the same amenity boy, you still need to have the same concierge, you still need to have a reception. So labor cost is a fixed cost.
Yes.
So you don't compare them by per occupied room. You compare only the variable expenses, means amenities, like bathroom amenities. So your cost of your shampoo in the hotel room will depend on how many rooms are occupied, right? If more occupied means more expense, less means the staff is not going to wash themselves, right?
Yes.
Unless staff is washing themselves, then it's a different thing. But usually there is no expense. So it depends on the variable expenses. So only variable expenses are covered for per room, per staff, per cover. And breakage. So how many items are broken down? Okay. Marketing reports. Then you have market segmentation report that we will discuss. What is the market segmentation report? Then you sometimes you want to understand the guest geography, means who are the nationality of the guest, right? Where they are coming from. They are Chinese, they are Indonesian, they are Bangladeshi, they are Japanese, they are Europeans, Americans, Indians, where are they? Who are they? So that you can understand where the business of the hotel is coming from. Then you have your pickup reports, how much business you pick up every day, or how much business you have picked up this month, right? And your cancellation, what is the business cancellation? So these are not actually accounting and finance report, these are just a marketing report that I'm telling you. But you don't need to learn this. We will not learn these reports in this class because this is not a part of the accounting. But these are operational reports. And you have revenue and cover analysis, menu engineering and other reports. And you have some function room revenue reports. So these are the main reports that finance is normally helping to prepare. And why I'm telling you this is because you need to maintain this data in the financial report. So in your memorandum and your statistics account, you can maintain all this data. So market segmentation report, your geographical reports. If you don't maintain it, then it's very difficult for you to take out the report. Let's say you are doing accounting or you are asking your finance to do the account, to generate this report. How will you make sure that that data is correct? Unless it's recorded somewhere in the system, right? So sometimes your property management system, your hotel management softwares are able to generate these reports. But many of the time we are using not so advanced hotel management software. So you will not be able to get the data. And it's difficult to maintain in Excel, right? So it's rather than that to define the chart of accounts, the statistical accounts, and keep it recording there. So once you record it, then whenever you want to generate the data is very easy. Correct? So when you are deciding your chart of accounts, when you are discussing your hotel accounting structure, you need to consider what accounting or marketing or operational report I need, so that you can design your chart of account in the same fashion. Okay, it's 12 o'clock. So we want to break for 10-15 minutes, or you want to, maybe 10 minutes. For coffee, loo, tea, water, anything you want. Okay, so we will break for lunch maybe around 12:30. So if you can order with them from outside, or you want to go outside, you can. We will break for only half an hour, not too long, for lunch. Okay, because we still have a lot of things to cover. Okay, so we only break for 5 minutes, huh? Water break. If you have any specific questions in your mind, you can ask later.
So for this slide, we can get it from the email.
Yes.
What we have now, the classroom.
Yes. Oh, I think on the classroom I didn't upload yet.
Yeah.
I can upload on the Google Classroom.
For the step of transition and benefits, like the step gradually, which amount is considered to calculate from HR or finance?
Both.
Both.
It should be both. Normally, is calculated by HR. In basic information is given by HR, but calculated by finance.
Same like also this, key image.
Okay. So some fundamental of accounting that we discuss before we proceed into more details. Okay. So fundamental of accounting means there are a couple of terms that we normally use in total accounting or any accounting usually. One is called accrual, allocations and prepayments. So what is accrual? So accruals are, there are two basic type of accounting. One is called cash accounting, cash book, cash accounting, cash basis, where you record your all expenses and income only when you receive a cash. And the other one is called accrual basis, means you record your expenses when they actually happen, no matter you pay or you don't pay. So that's called accrual basis. So in case revenue is, income is recognized when we receive or expenses when we pay that. But the in accrual accounting, we record income when it actually happened. So if let's say you accrual, you get a room occupied today in this month, but you didn't get the money yet because maybe you sell it for a 30-day credit. So you need to recognize as an income in this month, correct? Because your all expenses to serve that room, to do the servicing of that room is done in this month, not in next month, in this month. So this is, we call is a matching concept. Matching of your revenue and expenses in the same month when they are happening. Okay, so the matching of the expenses is also called to the period, in which period they are happening. So for cash accounting, it's very impossible to analyze the revenue for each month because you will not record when it's accruing. You will record when it's actually happening, actually being collected, and also its expenses are also not complete. But for accrual accounting, it's the international standards nowadays. They don't accept cash basis of accounting anymore. They accept only the accrual. So accrual means, and they need to, but the only problem is we need to maintain a lot of records. For example, you didn't pay the, so if let's say you didn't collect the revenue. So means instead of not recording it, you need to record the income and create another account for the travel agent. Correct? And then when you record the income, when you collect it, then you have to do another transaction. So you have to maintain two different transactions in two different ones and one extra ledger. So it's an extra work for accounting team to do. But that's the actual thing. So accrual means even if you don't pay the expense, you still need to recognize as your expense. So when you are reviewing your P&L, when you are checking your general ledgers, you need to be careful to see is there any major expense which you know it has been done already but it's not recorded by the finance. The reason is if you don't do that, then next month when they pay, they will recognize as an expense. And then you will not be able to explain to your GM or A2 to match with the revenue for that particular month. So your statistics will be up and down, right, for each month. You will not be able to compare month by month how much percentage of revenue I have or how much percentage of expenses I have compared to the each revenue of each month. So the accrual, we do accounting treatment in this way. So in the month when we expend, in the month of expense, we recognize them as an expense and we create an accrual account for expenses and then we credit that account. In the month of payment, you normally you continue to re-accrual. So that's accrual, it's a prudent accounting that until and unless you pay, you continue to accrue that expense. And normally it's auto-reversal. So every month you make an accrual, let's say this month you made an accrual. Same month, and the next month, it will, the previous one will be reversed. And you need to make a fresh one. So if let's say your rental is, you didn't pay for 1 month and 2 months also. So one first month, you need to accrue, okay, rent, expense rent account and credit to the accrual account. Next month, the previous one is automatically reversed. So if you didn't pay for the previous month and this month also, so it means you now need to accrual for 2 months, correct? And then third month, fourth month, if you are not paying it. And then whenever you pay, you need to charge to the expense directly. So if you already charge to the expense, then you don't need to make an accrual again because it's already paid. So in the month of payment, you will record as expense and credit to the cash account. So accrual accounting, in accrual account, you don't need to do anything because it's automatically reversed the previous one. The benefit of doing this is to understand how many months you haven't paid the expenses yet. If you don't adjust the previous one, if you don't do the, if you don't reverse the previous one, you will not get an idea how long it has been unpaid for. So the final, but the only downside is finance need to make a lot of data. They need to continue checking how many months we haven't paid yet, correct? But they can always refer to the previous month and check the cash flow. So sometimes it may have a risk that the finance may have charged to the expense and still make an accrual, means double expense, recognizing double expenses. So when you are reviewing your general ledger for detail of expenses, you need to be careful. Is it some accruals might have been paid already, but because sometimes it's two different people, accrual is done by one person, payment is done by another person. So sometimes they don't talk to each other, so they record double. So that one's the only thing you need to be very careful. Okay, allocation. As we discussed, allocation is for common expenses to individual departments, because there are many departments which serve for all the hotel departments. So you need to allocate the expenses, and most these are the common expenses which you normally allocate. So laundry expense, flower and decoration, canteen, amenities, and then you have the other common kitchen equipments. If you have, let's say your hotel has more than one kitchen, so you may have your big three kitchens combined, commissary kitchen combined. So those kitchens are serving everyone else. So their cost need to allocate to the individual kitchens so that you can understand the profitability of each restaurant separately. If let's say you have five restaurants and your pastry is combined, if you don't allocate the expenses, so your restaurant P&L is not complete, because it doesn't include the cost of some departments, right? Unless you allocate them. So how you allocate the kitchen expenses? Based on how many breads they make? Let's say there's one pastry chef who is making breads for all your three restaurants. So how will you allocate the cost?
Food transfer.
That's the actual food. How about the labor cost? Food is okay, you can, because based on how much food is transferred.
Yes.
Because food, they can maintain a record of food. But how will you record the labor? How will you allocate the labor cost? Divide by all outlets. But if let's say one outlet is the bigger one and another is very small, so how will you allocate? Percentage of the food is basically you can see, okay, what is the value of food that they prepare for each outlet. Also, if somebody is preparing for, let's say, the cost, not the value, not cost. So if they are preparing $10,000 for a restaurant A and only $1,000 for restaurant B, means most of their time is used in A restaurant. So they will allocate based on their preparing the food cost. So the cost of food is there, plus the labor cost will also be allocated based on the cost of food, which is allocated to the outlets. So that's how you allocate a common labor cost. Stewards, how you derive the stewards? Steward, there is no food cost, right?
Yeah.
So how you will derive the food cost for stewards? If let's say one steward department is there, combining all the restaurants. So cleaning is, you cannot count the dishes, how many dishes they clean, right?
Yeah.
So
the equipment for the use.
Sometimes restaurant use the same equipment also.
Yeah.
Sometimes they share the plates. So how will you allocate? Based on number of guests who eat in that restaurant.
Okay.
Because means the more restaurants are eating, means the more dishes they need to clean, right? So the cost will allocate based on where the number of guests are more. So it's based on number of covers. How many covers are being served? But Let's say it's an all-day dining restaurant where you don't need a lot of spoon and fork and dinner and all, but compared with a Chinese restaurant, for one cover in Chinese restaurant, you need to prepare, you need to serve, you need to have a soap, you need to have a soup cover, you need to have a table, you need to have a side, you need to have the dish, you need to have the mise en place, you need to have sauce, so many things, right? For one best. But consider that an all-day dining restaurant where you serve a burger, just only one plate, finish. So, but you cannot actually account for all the things. So, only thing is, you just make an assumption. Based on number of covers is the most logical usage to allocate the common cost. So, each hotel can have their own different method of allocating the common cost depending on how is their costs are determined. But the only thing you need to remember is, we need to be consistent. Means you don't change it every month, the basis. The basis need to remain the same. Otherwise, your cost structure will be upside down every month. Okay? And what is the pre-payment?
Pre-payment.
License.
License means pre-payment means paying the expenses which is covering for more than one period. So paying in advance, right? So normally your license cost, your rental, which you have to pay 1 year in advance for whole year, your uniforms, which you have to stage for one time for maybe 3 days, three sets or four sets. So these are all prepayments. Means your expenses which are paid in advance for more than one period of service. But it's not same as advance. Advance means you haven't get the service yet. Prepayments means you are getting the service. Start already, but you have paid for it advance already. Okay, so it's amortized over a period of the service and is aimed to match the revenue with the same similar services. So, a rental you allocate every month for the whole year. If you pay for 1 year, 2 year, 3 year, then you divide by the number of period and charge each month separately. So, when you are reviewing or you are checking your P&L, your expenses, then you need to see, is it all prepayments are done correctly or not? But don't try to, this is one way to hide an expense. So you can lower down your expense for each month by dividing them into the future months. So this is one way of, if let's say you are a staff and you want to report to the GM and GM don't want to see a very high expense. So you, even though you have expense, you can divide into different parts and report lower number. So if you become a GM or you are a GM already, then you can check your staff. Are they hiding their expenses or not? So accounting treatment for the prepayment is also done in the same way. So you pay first and record as a prepayment, and then you charge off to the systematically to each month, and you divide and you note down what is the time, how many time it is. So if it's the first month, then you say, and how many out of how many months? So you can say insurance, let's say, you can say this is the second amortization out of 12. So at least you know every month how many months are still left to pay the next month, right? Okay, set up the cost center. So how we set up cost centers? So we first is we need to identify what are the major independent revenue centers. Means major independent revenue center means where they are not depending on each other. So rooms is one which is not depending on the F&B, right? F&B mostly is, if let's say you have a hotel and you have only one restaurant, correct? And it's mostly the people who are coming for breakfast. No, not many come for lunch or not many come for dinner, maybe 1 or 2%. So is it a separate independent restaurant or is depending on the room?
Depending on the room.
Why?
Because breakfast is up to the room
occupied, right? So if there is no outside guest, so do you need to record a separate revenue or no need?
Why you need it? Outside.
It depends. And if your intention is to sell it for outsiders, then yes, you do it to record. And the chef or there is a manager who is responsible for the revenue, then yes, you can report it as a separate cost center. But if let's say there is no manager or no you're not doing much efforts to sell it for outside guests, it's only for in-house people. So you don't need to record it separately. Correct. Or if they say there's no much of the cost, it was only some food cost and some labor, couple of people who are preparing the breakfast, then you can merge everything together and record as a one cost center. Because that's how you can minimize your allocations. Otherwise, you have to record separately as a F&B, correct? But if you are intending to sell it as a separate restaurant, or intending to have a lunch, have dinner also, and you want to get outside covers, then you can record it separately and give a target to the manager or supervisor, whoever is responsible for that place, correct? So it depends what is the objective. So if they are two separate departments, if the major cost and revenue can be identified separately. Okay, for example, like if you can identify the cost, let's say you are selling rooms all inclusive of breakfast and your outlet is serving nothing else other than the breakfast. So how will you separate? This is very difficult to separate a cost and revenue. Because revenue means you need to allocate a breakfast revenue. So how will you allocate? Only based on food cost or only based on labor cost? Since it's only based on the one department, so it's better to combine so that you don't have to separate out the cost. And if they can run independent of each other. So for example, breakfast in a small restaurant. What if there is a lunch and dinner revenue? Then it's a separate lunch, separate cost center already. Because you cannot separate the lunch and dinner cost, labor cost from breakfast. So it's better to keep it separate and allocate the breakfast revenue. But if there is no lunch and dinner, then it's either better to merge together with the room department. And then if let's say there is a room service. So if let's say room service mostly is prepared by the same chef as your any other restaurant. And service is also done by the same. So you still need, do you still need to record room revenue, room service revenue separately or not? Let's say, right, you may have one restaurant. You have a choice, the guest can order from the room service, right? You need to just, but there is no separate kitchen for room. There is no separate staff for room service. If the guest order at the reception, they tell the restaurant, okay, please go and serve. So the chef make it and staff serve it. So do you need to record separately or no need? No need, right? Because you cannot separate the food kitchen, food restaurant. You cannot, the chef is not buying separately for room service only. And the service staff is also the same. So it's very difficult to separate the cost of food and cost of service. So you don't need to run two separate departments for that. You can just run only one department. Okay? But only revenue you can record separately. How much has come from the room and how much come from the other guest. So you can compare the revenue only. No need to compare the expenses. And then you have a Chinese restaurant and a banquet. Normally the banquet, if let's say you have a Chinese restaurant, you are serving for functions, usually it's served by the same kitchen. So it depends on how big is your banquet operations and what is the cost allocation. Then you can record it separately. Otherwise, you can merge together with the restaurant business. Okay? The only thing is, it's important to establish the cost allocation process. If you want to separate the cost center, then the major important part is how you will separate the cost in future. What will be the basis of cost allocation? You will allocate based on food, you will allocate based on number of covers, you will allocate based on the, or you will maintain a separate record for each cost center. So important is, you need to identify the allocation process. What will be the allocation process for your department? Okay, so chart of accounts, normally we decide based on the business of the hotel. What are the main businesses of the hotel? In the standard P&L, you will see there are a lot of lines, lot of expenses, lot of account heads. But all of them may not apply to you. Or maybe some of them maybe require a separate accounting, but only one transaction in a whole year. So you don't need to run a separate account for one transaction or two transactions in a year. You can combine them as a miscellaneous revenue, or you can combine them into the other related expenses, because there are many lines which are very similar to each other, but only technically they are different slightly. So you will see in the Excel file,
I will show you the Excel file, which is here.
These are the total line around 1800. Sorry, these are the total expenses, about 351 lines. So these are the different accounts for each department. For example, A and G. So in this Excel file, you will be able to know what is going into the audit charges. So what will go to audit charges? You can double click. And then you will see what will go into the audit fees. It will go audit fees, internal audit, and internal audit fees for chain property. So these are the line item will go into this particular expense line. So you can know there are all the expense accounts, but it's not necessary for you. If let's say you don't have audit in your hotel, you don't have audit, so you don't need to create another chart of account for audit fees, because you don't have retention. So there is no point in creating the chart of accounts which is standard, but you don't use them. So you use them based on how much you are actually using the transaction. Okay. So the idea is to segregate the similar nature items into fixed and variable. So if let's say you have some cost account which has a fixed and variable expenses both, then you need to create a sub account for fixed expense separately and record variable expenses separately. Why you need to do that? Because you can analyze variable expenses based on your statistics, your per occupied room, your per cover expenses, but fixed expenses you need to analyze based on the total only, right? So it will be easier for you to segregate the expenses or analyze it later if you combine them. If you merge everything in one line, in one chart of account, it will be very difficult to segregate later on and analyze the account unless you maintain it separately. For example, in the amenities, right? In the amenities, you can record housekeeping, the bathroom amenities separately and your linen separately. If you combine them together, you have no idea how the account will move per occupied room. Linen is not moving per occupied room, right? Linen is usually depend if it's damaged. It's a fixed expense or on an account, on and off expense. You may have it, you may not have it, depending on if it's getting damaged or if it's not getting damaged. Correct? So you should record it separately so that you can analyze the expenses based on how they are behaving. Per occupied room, depending on the occupancy or not depending on occupancy. And also you can say, variable means guest, variable per guest, per occupied room, separately. Also you can record separate how they behave. Some expenses depending on the rooms, occupied rooms. Some expense depending on the guest. Some expense depend on the business, directly due to the revenue. For example, booking.com. Correct. It does not depend on the occupancy. It depends on the revenue, because it goes from revenue, maybe 10% of revenue, 15% of revenue. So booking.com commission, if in your commission account itself, you can have separate account for booking.com, separate for group commission, or separate for travel agent commission. Correct. Because those are all different. If let's say to some travel agent, you are paying per booking instead of room. You are paying maybe another hotel concierge $5 per occupied per room or per booking. So that account will behave in a different manner than the booking.com, which you are paying based on revenue. Correct? So you can combine, you can segregate the commission account into different sub accounts so that you can analyze it in the future. Okay, and separate the non-recurring items means expenses which are only once in a while. So you can separate them out and club them into maybe miscellaneous or other expenses, because these are the expenses which you don't need to analyze. But it's important to know what are the non-recurring items. What is not happening every day, or every month, or every year. Some expenses doesn't happen only year, right? Some expenses happens only once in a year, or maybe one time only. After that, it doesn't happen again. So if you combine all expenses together, it's very difficult to analyze. So it's better to separate out the non-recurring items.
So, I have a question. So, what about the marketing? So, like the marketing, like we do the barter agreement, we give a room, right? But we advertise to in the newspaper. In this course, it's called go to marketing, right?
Yes.
And this this course where we like, let's say, the room is equivalent, we sell the $100. But we add $100 or we add only cost price to marketing.
It depends on what is the barter agreement.
Okay.
Let's say you you will see the standalone prices.
Yes.
For example, if let's say you say, okay, to advertise in this newspaper, normal price is $100.
Yes.
Or $1,000.
Yes.
So I am giving ten rooms,
yes,
to Ecoline, and I am selling my rooms. Normally, the barter agreement, how they work is, you are taking the standalone prices of both. If let's say the marketing expense, if you don't do a barter in cash, you need to pay $1,000. Correct? You will see, okay, how many rooms I should be able to give for that particular $1,000. So let's say you are normally selling room for 200. So means you should give five rooms, right? But if you give five rooms, then it's easier. You can record 1,000 as your revenue and 1,000 as your expense. But what if you give 10 rooms because you are not able to negotiate, or maybe the other company is negotiating better? You give 10 rooms, so you are giving a value of $2,000 from your side, and what you are getting it back is only $1,000. So the question is, how will you record? In that case, you will base on your cost. How much is the value you are getting back? You are getting back a value of $1,000 only. So your revenue will also be $1,000. Even though you normally can sell for 2,000, then but your revenue will still remain at 1,000 only, because what you are getting back in return is worth at 1,000. Correct? For other department, other party, they can record at 2,000 because they are getting back a worth of 2,000. Means they are selling their services equivalent to 2,000, right? Because you can, if they come as a direct by paying a normal customer, they need to pay $2,000 to your room, right? But and so means they are selling their services for 2,000 for you, and you are selling your room for only 1,000. So for you, you will record 1,000 as revenue, 1,000 as expense. In which month you will record?
In the same
month.
Same month.
Let's say you advertise today, but the room is not occupied today. You just give them a voucher,
yeah,
and they use it next year.
So we have to divide the.
No.
Okay, you mean the which month we add? And as a rule is, we have to add the same month. Like they use maybe after 6 months. We have to add the 6 months only. But for the advertise, it's coming as a.
In which month the advertisement is appearing?
Yeah.
So if let's say this month advertisement appears, so your expense will be recognized in this month. And you will recognize the liability. Because you give a room revenue, you are giving a free room, right? So you will recognize the liability for barter. And when they actually use the room, then you, in that month, you will recognize the revenue and adjust the liability. Okay? So revenue and expenses will be recognized when they actually happen, not when the contract is made. So contract can be made today, but maybe barter, the advertisement will be done next month or next year. So it depends on when they are using the services. So actual expense will be recorded at the time of actual usage. Okay? So then you can look at the detail of each chart of accounts. For example, this is one example of complementary services and gift. So in this case, you can see there are many type of different accounts, right? You have the welcome gift, you have amenities, you have main guest, parking, complimentary snacks, newspaper, banquet basket, welcome baskets, promotional gift, all goes to complimentary services and gift in room division. But if let's say you want to analyze the expenses, so you need to segregate the expenses into same, which are behaving in the same manner. For example, MGDs will base on the how many number of guests are using it. But promotional gift doesn't depend on the how many guests are occupied. It depends on how many guests or what kind of marketing activity you are doing. So you can segregate the expenses into different sub accounts so that you can analyze it in the future. Okay? You will find more details in the Excel sheet. So you can look at the Excel sheet. So this is one of the statistic example that we discussed earlier, right? Total available rooms is 100. Okay, then under renovation is 4. Rooms your internal use is 5. So total rooms not available are 9. So rooms sellable room will be 91. So all your statistics will based on 91 only, not based on 100 anymore. So if you actually your occupied rooms are, let's say, total occupied rooms is 12,000. Complimentary room is 200. So room sold is only 11,800, actual room sold. So your occupancy will be based on actual room sold, 11,800 divided by 33,000. Here I am dividing into two separate parts because we are assuming, let's say the hotel is running for 6 months only, which is normally the case in Myanmar. If let's say you have a rest hotel in beach and you are closing down for 6 months, so you will be calculating or based on 180 days, not on 365 days, correct? Because you are not selling it to the public. So if you can see the occupancy statistics will be very different if you combine for whole year or you combine only for 6 months. So here you can say occupancy is based on the number of rooms available for sale, not based on total number of available. Every daily rate is also based on available room sold only. So J divided by H, H is room sold, which is 1 million divided by 11,800. And RevPAR will be based on here, sellable rooms, not available rooms. Okay? And these are the some of the formulas. You will find that in the book to calculate the occupancy. Okay. You want to have a break, lunch first, right? And then after lunch, we will do this all the detail accounting for each division. Okay? Thank you.